Hello and welcome to this video on pluggable refreshable clones on the Exadata database service running on Exascale. From the main menu, I will select Oracle Database and then Oracle Exadata Database running on Exascale service. From here, I will select the region where my clusters are created, and I'm giving a list of my Exascale clusters. I will select one of them. This takes me to the cluster page. And if I scroll down, I can see the cluster has two container databases. Let's select one. If I scroll down on the container database and select the pluggable databases link, I can see this container database has multiple pluggable databases associated with it. If we were to select one of these pluggable databases, let's select RWPDB2. This will take us to the pluggable database page, and I can select the clone button. I have the options of creating a local clone or remote clone, and we'll look at this in a different video. Today we're looking at refreshable clones. The refreshable clone option allows me to create a refreshable clone of the source pluggable database in a different container database. This refreshable clone will be opened read-only, but it allows us to update the contents of that clone based on the source pluggable database. If I move down, I can select the cluster where my container database will be hosted. So I'm going to use the same cluster, and I'm going to select the target container database. This is going to be the database where we create the refreshable clone. I'm going to give my refreshable clone a name. We'll call it TestPDB7, and I need to provide the TDE wallet password. I also need to provide the source database's sys password. With a local clone and remote clone, it's optional whether we provide a database link username. But with a refreshable clone, because we are going to be using the database link to refresh the contents of that clone, we need to provide a link username and a link password. To do this, we'll open up a terminal and we'll connect to the source container database. Our source container database is going to be RWDB1. So I've switched to the Oracle user. I'm setting the environment variable, for that container database. And now I'm going to connect to that database. This is the source database. If I look at the PDBs, we can see our PDB there, RWPDB2. And now we need to create a common user, a common database user that will use the or own the database link. So I'm going to create a user, a common user called CSysOpper. I'm going to obviously provide the password for that user I'm creating. And I'm going to open the account. Now we've created that user, I'm going to grant that user some privileges, create session. I'm going to grant it create pluggable database. And I'm also going to give it the SysOpper role as well. I'm now going to switch my session and I'm going to jump into the source pluggable database, RWPDB2. And now I'm in that pluggable database, I'm going to provide the same grants to that common user we just created. So create session, create pluggable database, and the SysOpper role. We can now exit the source database. And our target database is on the same cluster, so I can stay on the same system, and I can connect to the, I've set my environment for the target container database, and then I will connect to the target container database. On the target container database, I need to check the open links parameter. I need to be sure that the target database can create create database links. I can see it's set to 10 here, and I know that this is above the number I need. But if this value was set to 0, so you weren't allowed to create links, or that number was exactly matching the number of links that had been created, you would need to increase this value. So these values are non-modifiable. That means you need to update them in the SP file and then restart the instance. We're good. We have enough. We're set to 10 for open links and open links per instance. So we can exit from the target database and we can go back to our OCI screen. Now that we've created the user in the source database, we can provide those details under the database link username and password correspondingly. If I look at show advanced options, my only option is tags. I can add tags if I want to, and then I can click on the clone a pluggable database button. This takes me to the pluggable database, the refreshable clone that we're creating. We can see the work request has been accepted and the pluggable database is provisioning. I will speed the provisioning up for the sake of time on this video. Now that the refreshable clone has been provisioned, we can go to VM cluster details, select our cluster, look at our container database, target DB, where we provisioned the refreshable clone, select on pluggable databases, and there in the list we can see our refreshable clone. It has a state of available, but note also that it has a refreshable clone marked as yes, where the other pluggable databases are marked as no. So this shows us very quickly that this pluggable database is a refreshable clone. Note also that the open mode for this pluggable database is mounted. So if we click Start PDB, that job is accepted. Note that when it does open, it opens as read only. Now, this is because it's a refreshable clone and refreshable clones are read only. When the refreshable clone is being refreshed, it's done in mounted state. Sometimes it may start and it may indicate that it's in read-write mode. This is sometimes there's a short delay between the sync of the actual PDB and the OCI console. If it does open in read-write mode, you'll soon see that it will switch to read-only mode shortly afterwards. Let's open a terminal. And set the environment for the source database. Let's log on to the source container database. We can see our source pluggable database, RWPDB2. This is what the refreshable clone is based on. So let's connect to that pluggable database and let's make some changes to it that weren't in place when we provisioned the refreshable clone. So this is going to be very simple, very basic, but it will show the point. So we can see we're connected to the pluggable database. So let's create a user in that pluggable database. This is a local user to the pluggable database. We'll call it test user. We'll give it a password. We'll provide a default tablespace for it and we'll unlock the account. For ease of use, let's just basically grant some basic privileges to that user, grant create session, create table to our test user. Let's grant unlimited table space use. And now let's create a table for that user. So we'll create a user test user dot test table one. Let's insert a row of data into that test table. And let's commit that data. If we now go to our target database, and this doesn't have to be on the same cluster, this could have been on a separate cluster, a different VM. Let's connect to it. Let's connect to our refreshable clone. Notice that it's in read-only state. So let's alter the session and connect to it. So we're now connected to our refreshable clone pluggable database. And if we look at usernames from DBA users, we'll see there is no user called test user. Let's go back to our console and refresh the clone. We can do this under the more actions option and then refresh. It's asking, are we sure? We'll say yes. At this point, the PDB will go into refreshing mode. As mentioned earlier, the open mode shows read-only, but the actual PDB will be in a mounted state. It takes sometimes a little while for the open mode on the OCI console to catch up with the actual state of the PDB. Now, we can see that the work request is in progress at 20%, and depending on how much data needs to be refreshed, it will depend on how quick this operation is. Obviously, we've just created a very small amount of data, just one table, one row, but in reality, this could be substantially longer depending on the amount of change within the source pluggable database. We can see the PDB is back as available. The status of the work request is succeeded. So now we need to go open a terminal, go back to our refreshable clone. So we will log into the target container database. We will connect to our refreshable pluggable database, which is test PDB7. If we now look for our test user account, we can see that user is there and it's open. And if we try to select from the table we created under that user, and we can see the data is there, the data has been refreshed. So there's many uses for refreshable clones, and you can see how easy it is to refresh, and you can refresh as many times as you need to. But we could also convert our refreshable clone into a regular PDB. So that is, break the link, but it will then become its full standalone read-write pluggable database. So if we select the convert to a regular PDB under the more actions option, we can undertake this task. So we need to provide the TDE wallet password, and we also need to decide whether, once we've converted the pluggable database, whether we want to take a backup immediately after creating it. We won't in this case, so we deselect the tick box for that and then hit submit. So we can see the PDB is updating, and we will get a work request for that conversion shortly. So I'll speed the conversion process up. And we can see that it's now succeeded. Notice that the open mode is now read-write. It's no longer a refreshable clone. And again, the open mode may take several minutes to actually refresh from the read-only to the read-write based on the sync. Notice if we go to the more actions, we can no longer do refresh because we have broken that link. And note also that the refreshable clone mode is now set to no. This concludes the video. I hope it's been useful for you. Thank you for watching.